Hey guys, today I'd like to discuss about pharmacology of diuretics. So before I should go to diuretics, what is a diuretic, right? What is a diuretic? Which means diuretic is a drug, when it enters your body system, it will increase your urine output. So diuretic is a drug which increase our urine output. Where exactly it acts? It acts on the nephron of our kidney, right? So we have five groups of major diuretics. So that includes thiazide diuretics, loop diuretics, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, potassium sparing and osmotic diuretics. How they are classified? They are classified, for example, when I am telling loop diuretics, they act on the loop of Henle. So when I am telling thiazide diuretics, so the derivatives are from thiazides. Osmotic diuretics, their mechanism is by osmotic mechanism. And carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they inhibit the enzyme carbonic anhydrase. Alright. Now, what exactly, how exactly they work on our nephron, we'll discuss. So for going that, I should tell how water is reabsorbed. Water majorly follows sodium. I will explain you that. So it will be easier for us to understand. So where exactly it will act? It acts on the nephron of our kidney, right? So we'll draw our nephron. So this is Bowman's capsule. Proximal convoluted tubule. This is our thick descending limb of loop of Henle. Thin descending and ascending loop of Henle. Thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. And here we have our distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct. Right. Here we have our glomerulus. Efferent and afferent arterioles, right? So why I am talking about sodium reabsorption here? Because in kidney, wherever there is a sodium reabsorption, there is a water reabsorption also, but passively. Wherever there is a sodium reabsorption, there is a water reabsorption. So if we act directly on the sodium reabsorption, definitely we can change our urine output. So here is our proximal convoluted tubule, right? So here is a some percent of sodium reabsorption. So that is about 70% of sodium is reabsorbed to the blood in proximal convoluted tubule. About 25% is reabsorbed in the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. So that is sodium. So here sodium is not only reabsorbed, here it is also reabsorbed with chloride. So this one we call it as a transporter or a symport. In distal convoluted tubule also we have a symport, that is a transporter that also reabsorbs sodium and chloride. Right. Not only in the distal convoluted tubule, here also we have our sodium reabsorption, but sodium reabsorption in the collecting duct is totally different. Here sodium is reabsorbed and potassium is secreted into the lumen. So that is how they differ in the reabsorption, right? So to know the mechanism of diuretics, we should know the percentage of sodium absorbed and where exactly reabsorbed. So we'll start with the mechanism of diuretics action, right? So first one, we'll start with osmotic diuretics. So how exactly osmotic diuretics act? Here we have our proximal convoluted tubule. Let's draw only the small part of proximal convoluted tubule here. So nephron is made up of what? Epithelial cells. Let's draw the epithelial cells of the nephron here. So this is a epithelium of the nephron. And they have a special protein which binds between them. The epithelial cells are bind by a protein here. Right. So one side will be, so this will be our lumen. Right, this will be our blood. So how exactly osmotic diuretics work here is, when I put a osmotic diuretics such as mannitol and urea intravenously to the person, so that comes to our nephron by afferent arteriole. Right. When it reaches to the nephron by afferent arteriole, what will happen? Here it is filtered. Where? Into the Bowman's capsule. So it is filtered into the primary urine. Once osmotic diuretic is filtered into the primary urine, it passes to the lumen of the proximal convoluted tubule. So osmotic diuretics majorly act in the proximal convoluted tubule. So we know the location of action. Once it is filtered into the lumen, these drugs have a special property. They are not reabsorbed into the blood again. So when they are not reabsorbed into the blood again, what will happen? They increase the osmotic concentration. I mean, they increase the concentration of the urine. So they increase the concentration of the drug that will lead to the... So if concentration is high here, concentration is low here. Right. What is the rule of osmosis? It will follow high concentration to the low concentration. But what happens when once it is a higher concentration here, it doesn't allow water to go back. Right. Water should be absorbed and reabsorbed to the blood, right? So once concentration is high over here, what will happen? Water should come in this way. So it won't let water to reabsorb back into the blood by increasing the osmotic concentration in the lumen of the nephron. So this is the mechanism of action of osmotic diuretics. So how they are given? They are majorly given intravenously. And what are the indications for osmotic diuretics? Generally, they are used in acute conditions such as brain and pulmonary edema. Brain and pulmonary. Brain and pulmonary edema. Not only in the brain and pulmonary edema, they are also used during the poisonings. Why we use them during poisonings? That's because we want to induce diuresis. When we induce the diuresis, the compound, whatever was in the person's blood who was poisoned, it can be flushed out easily. So this is the osmotic diuretics. What are the side effects? Major side effects of osmotic diuretics will be volume depletion. So we have to monitor the patient's blood pressure. We'll start with the another type of diuretics. That is our loop diuretics, right? So let me draw the loop here. This is the thick descending loop of Henle, thin descending and ascending loop of Henle, and here we have our thick ascending loop of Henle. So I told here sodium is reabsorbed and along with chloride. So sodium and chloride are reabsorbing, right? So how exactly the loop diuretics function, I'll explain. So let's draw the loop over here. So when I'm drawing the loop over here, this will be our epitheliums. And here we have our lumen and blood. So when I am explaining about the loop diuretics, I want to explain you some important concept of the epithelial cells of the nephron, right? So on the luminal side, we may have channels, transporters, whatever it may be, but this will be the luminal side of the epithelium. This will be basolateral side. We call it as towards the blood, whatever is there, we call it as basolateral side. So in basolateral side, we have something called as sodium and potassium ATPase. NaNK plus ATPase. So what they do, they involve in the reabsorption of the sodium and potassium. Right. So I told there is a transporter. So the transporter, where it will be located? It will be located in the luminal side. So if sodium is reabsorbed from the lumen to the cell, further it is reabsorbed to the blood by sodium and potassium ATPase. So what exactly our loop diuretics such as furosemide and bumetanide does, they inhibit this chloride ion absorption. So once the chloride ion is inhibited, so they are co-transporter, they are transported together. Once I am not allowing chloride to go inside, the sodium also not reabsorbed. When sodium not reabsorbed, increase the osmolarity of the lumen. So that will lead to massive diuresis. So this is a mechanism of loop diuretics. So indication for loop diuretics includes brain and pulmonary edema. Same thing. Brain and pulmonary edema. But not only brain and pulmonary edema we use the loop diuretics, we also use it for the acute hypertension. Means you see a patient with, for example, high levels of blood pressure. He didn't know he had a blood pressure, but he comes to you, you see very high blood pressure. You can use loop diuretics so that the blood pressure is relieved immediately. So once sodium and chloride, along with that, potassium also reabsorbed over here. So potassium also not reabsorbed, right? So all these three ions are not reabsorbed. What will happen? They are lost via urine. So they are lost via urine. When they are lost via urine, what will happen? So that will be our hyponatremia because of loss of sodium ions. Loss of potassium ions lead to hypokalemia, and hypochloremia is also possible. So that is the side effects of the loop diuretics, right? So we'll start with the next type of diuretics. And mode of administration for loop diuretics, we have availability of both intravenous and tablets. We'll start with the next type of diuretics, that is carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Right. Let's draw our proximal convoluted tubule again. So we have our proximal convoluted tubule. I told about 70% of the sodium is reabsorbed, right? Along with that, here bicarbonate also reabsorbed. So that is major alkali of our body. Bicarbonate is a major alkali of our body. So let's enlarge and try it over here. So we have our epithelial cells here. Right, so this will be our lumen and this will be our blood, right? How exactly their function is, so bicarbonate is filtered over here, so we have bicarbonate in the luminal side. So here I told there is a sodium reabsorption, right? Here sodium reabsorption happens in a different way, that for every sodium ion reabsorbed, for every sodium ion reabsorbed, one hydrogen is secreted into the lumen. So one ion should be reabsorbed means one hydrogen ion should be secreted into the lumen. When this hydrogen is secreted into the lumen, this bicarbonate and hydrogen combine together, they form H2CO3, right? So the H2CO3 is formed. In the lumen, we have something enzyme called carbonic anhydrase. That is carbonic anhydrase. When carbonic anhydrase act on the H2CO3, it will give water along with that carbon dioxide. So what is the property of our carbon dioxide? Carbon dioxide is a fat soluble, right? So once the carbon dioxide is fat soluble, it can easily go into the cell. So once carbon dioxide enters the cell, what will happen? I'll show it here. Carbon dioxide enters the cell, it will combine with intracellular water, right? Within the cell, we have lots of water. Again, by the action of which enzyme? Again, by the action of carbonic anhydrase, it forms H2CO3, right? So H2CO3 is formed, it is highly unstable. So it is highly unstable. It immediately gives hydrogen ion and bicarbonate. So this bicarbonate is reabsorbed back to the blood, and this hydrogen ion is involved in the exchange of the sodium reabsorption. So if I am inhibiting the enzyme which is carbonic anhydrase here and carbonic anhydrase in the cell, what will happen? There is no reabsorption of the sodium, because there is no reabsorption of the sodium because there is no hydrogen ion exchange happening. So when there is no hydrogen exchange is happening, so once sodium concentration is increased in the lumen, what will happen? It will cause diuresis. But the property of carbonic anhydrase diuretics is very, very, very mild diuretic. It is a very, very, very mild diuretics. That is why we don't really use carbonic anhydrase inhibitors for their diuretic properties. Once, if we are using these carbonic anhydrase inhibitors for a long time, what will happen? Bicarbonate is continuously lost. When bicarbonate is continuously losing, what will happen? This is the major alkali, right? So what will happen? It will lead to acidosis. So that is metabolic acidosis. That is the major side effect of our carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. So we have two more groups of diuretics. We will discuss the thiazide diuretics now. Thiazides. So thiazide diuretics includes which drugs, that is hydrochlorothiazide and chlorothiazide. So what happens, where the location of action of thiazide diuretics, that is distal convoluted tubule. So let's draw our distal convoluted tubule here. This is thick descending limb, thin descending and thin ascending limb, thick ascending limb, and here we have our distal convoluted tubule, right? I told earlier there is a symport, there is a transporter, same as that of our loop diuretics. So here there is a reabsorption of sodium and chloride. So this symport involved in the transport of the sodium and chloride. The same way these thiazide diuretics as loop diuretics, they will come and inhibit this channel. So they come and inhibit the transporter over here. Once the transporter is inhibited, what will happen? Increase the sodium ion concentration here. Once the sodium ion concentration is increased in the lumen, it is excreted by our kidney. So once the sodium is getting excreted, what will happen? It will take all water with it. So that will cause loss of water and it will cause diuresis. We need to get diuresis by giving a diuretic, right? So what is the side effect of this thiazide diuretics? Thiazide diuretics, before going to side effects, let's discuss about indications for thiazide diuretics. Thiazide diuretics used in the edemas. What type of edemas? So we have patient with chronic heart failure. We have patient with liver cirrhosis. So this liver cirrhosis and chronic heart failure patients, they will have recurrent edemas. So edemas caused by congestive heart failure and our liver cirrhosis. Not only here, we also use them in hypertension patient. But what hypertension patient? For the long term use of the hypertension disease. So this is the story of our thiazide diuretics. We have special indication for thiazide diuretics. One major indication, that is diabetes insipidus. Why I am stressing over diabetes insipidus? Because it will cause high concentrated loss of urine. Means it will lead to the concentrated urine, concentration of urine. This is a unique property of the thiazide diuretics. That is why it is used in the nephrogenic diabetes insipidus as well. For long term usage of these thiazide diuretics, they will cause hyperuricemia. That is hyperuricemia. What is hyperuricemia? Means it will decrease the excretion of the uric acid, and it will lead to increased accumulation of the uric acid within the body, and it will lead to hyperuricemia. So if the patient is having a gout, the thiazide diuretics are contraindicated, because in gout already uric acid levels is elevated in the patient's body. So we have our last group of diuretics, that is potassium sparing diuretics. So we have two groups of potassium sparing diuretics, that is aldosterone antagonist and other one is amiloride and triamethrin. So where exactly they act is in the collecting duct. So let's draw our collecting duct over here. So this is our distal convoluted tubule and here we have our collecting duct, right? So I will enlarge the collecting duct, this part over here. So here is our cells of the collecting duct, right? I told earlier on the basolateral membrane, that is side of the blood, we have special protein called sodium and potassium ATPase. This will be our lumen, right? So in collecting duct, what we have a specialized sodium and potassium channels. So whenever sodium ion is reabsorbed from the lumen to the cell, potassium is excreted or secreted from the cell to the lumen, right? So the potassium sparing diuretics, what they will do, they will come and inhibit the sodium channel. So when the sodium channel is inhibited, there is no exchange of potassium. So potassium is stored within the cell itself. When the potassium is stored within the cell itself, we are not losing potassium anymore. So when we are not losing potassium anymore, they get the name called potassium sparing diuretic. So what are the indications for potassium sparing diuretics? They are not such potent diuretics, but when we are giving diuretics for a long time, for example, hypertensive patients, they will have hypokalemia, right? So to avoid that hypokalemia, we can add with the other group of drugs. So that is a major indication for our potassium sparing diuretics. So I told another group of potassium sparing is there, that is our aldosterone antagonist, right? So we'll discuss that about aldosterone antagonist. So what is function of our aldosterone? When aldosterone is stimulated, when aldosterone receptor stimulated, what will happen? There is a sodium and water retention, right? So this is our cell. This is the blood, right? So what will happen? Here we have receptors of aldosterone. So aldosterone receptors. Why I am drawing it within the cell? Because aldosterone is a steroid. The cells are, the receptors for the aldosterone are within the cell. Once I am putting the drug and when I am blocking this receptor, what will happen? Aldosterone receptors are not anymore stimulated. When aldosterone receptors are not anymore stimulated, what happens? So generally in normal condition, when I am stimulating this aldosterone receptor, so it will produce, I mean it will stimulate the nucleus and it will produce an mRNA. mRNA. Once this mRNA is produced, what this mRNA will do? It will involve in the formation of sodium and potassium ATPase, right? So this receptor is a stimulator for formation of sodium and potassium ATPase. This is a specialized type of transport protein. So it will come and involve in the reabsorption of the sodium in the basolateral membrane, right? So when I am inhibiting this this receptor, there is no formation of sodium and potassium ATPase. If there is no formation of sodium and potassium ATPase, there is no reabsorption from the basolateral side of the epithelium of the collecting duct. When there is no reabsorption is happening, there is no reabsorption over here also, I mean to the luminal side. Because whatever it is reabsorbed, it is not transporting here. So if this transport is closed, there is no reabsorption of the sodium from the lumen. So this is the action of our potassium sparing diuretics. So what is the indication for these potassium sparing diuretics? This is also for the combination with other drugs. And we can use it also in the which condition? In the hyperaldosteronism. What happens? We are inhibiting the receptor. What happened in the hyperaldosterone? Aldosterone levels are increased. So this is the story of our diuretics. Keep following. Thank you.